We'll take our last speaker, and then after that, Srinivas, you could ask a question or two. Our last speaker, but not the least, is Dr. Mudit Tyagi, who's going to be taking on uveitis masquerade syndrome. Mudit Tyagi, doctor, heads the uvea services at LVPR Hyderabad, is a prolific retinal surgeon and has redefined the art of retinal surgeries for retinal detachment with his award-winning surgical innovation with fibrin glue. His passion for retina and teaching has made him a go-to figure amongst the younger retinal surgeons. On to you, Dr. Mudit.
Thank you so much for the kind words and for allowing me to be a part of this great webinar. So are my slides visible?
Yes.
And I'm audible. Yeah. Yes. So good evening. So I will be talking about masquerades in uveitis. And first of all, what do masquerades mean? So the word masquerade actually comes from Italian mascherata, or French mascarade, which basically means to pretend to be something else or to be someone which you actually are not. So pretense, deception, facade, disguise, those are the other synonyms for the word masquerade. So basically, uveitic masquerade syndromes are a group of disorders where actually the inflammatory process is not the real thing. There is an underlying different cause which has led to this sort of an appearance. So what initial disorder? So this is a photograph which is courtesy my colleague Dr. Anamika Patel, and this has already been mentioned by Dr. Manisha as well as Dr. Sudarshan. When you see a apparently seemingly quiet white eye with a atypical hypopyon, or a hypopyon which is either tinged with blood or brownish colored hypopyon, or a hypopyon in a kid, you should think of the fact that you might not be dealing with uveitis, but this is actually the presentation of a retinoblastoma. Now, in some of these eyes, we have a brown colored hypopyon. And why do we have that? The reason is that the necrotic iris and the dispersed melanin granules do get interspersed over here. And when you see a brown colored hypopyon, think also of a melanoma apart from tuberculosis or listeria. So let me show you a few cases. This was a 63-year-old patient who was a known case of diabetes, who came with a sudden decrease of vision in both his eyes. And though the left eye had a hypopyon inferiorly, the right eye had this entire blood coagulum and a blood-stained hypopyon. We went ahead, did an AC tap of this patient and a peripheral smear. And what it revealed was the presence of myeloblast, metamyelocytes, promyelocytes, and band cells. So this was a patient of a chronic myeloid leukemia. And a blood-stained hypopyon was a clue to an underlying malignancy in these cases. Now, when you see a patient who is already a known case of a blood dyscrasia, in those cases, the presence of a hypopyon becomes much more important, because then you might be the first person to diagnose the fact that probably your patient is either going into a relapse or is going into a blast crisis. So presence of a hypopyon in a known case of blood dyscrasia should alert you to, number one, either a relapse, number two, the fact that you might be, the patient might be going into a blast crisis, and thirdly, it may also show the spread of a CNS spread. And why does that happen? Because of the fact that there's a leptomeningeal involvement from pial arteries to the ciliary arteries, you get these tumor cells in the AC. So presence of a hypopyon should alert you to these three possibilities, either a relapse or a blast crisis or a CNS spread. And that's why ophthalmologists can become extremely valuable in identifying these cases early enough. So apart from that, there is one more disorder or one more entity which you should keep in mind, and that is drugs, because drugs can also mimic and cause infection, and you should have that as a high index of suspicion. So let me show you a patient. This was a lady who came with dense fibrinous reaction in both her eyes with DM4 circumciliary congestion. Vision was PL plus PR inaccurate in both the eyes. She also had a shallow AC and a stromal edema. Was actually diagnosed as a case of angle closure elsewhere and was advised for a YAC PI. But when we went ahead, we saw that the patient had peripheral choroidal detachments in both the eyes. And then the patient gave a history of using topiramate, which was started just 15 days ago. So topiramate as a drug is notorious to cause AC inflammation as well as choroidal detachments. So we discontinued topiramate, started the patient on topical steroids and cycloplegics, and within just 3 days, vision improved to 2060, 2200 in both the eyes. The membrane started regressing, and now the even pupillary and iris details are visible. The corneal edema had also regressed. CD started regressing. And in the interest of time, I will just move on to some other images. But at 1 week, most of the inflammation has gone. So you need to have that index of suspicion in your head. The CD is also regressed. This is another case. This was another patient who was referred to us and was initially thought of as a panophthalmitis. Then somebody thought of it as an endogenous endophthalmitis. Was actually presenting with a shallow AC. So somebody tried doing a PI over here. But again, when we took a history, the patient was taking topiramate. There was a peripheral CDs in all quadrants and a hypopyon in both eyes. So the clue here is to look at the fact and go back and take a meticulous history. And if you don't, then this is the kind of a disaster you might land up into. So this was another patient who had a chlorothalidone-induced inflammation. Was initially thought of as angle closure. Somebody tried doing a surgery in both the eyes and you end up with such a disastrous consequence with fibrin membranes. Ultimately, we had to go ahead, do a surgery, remove these, put oil inside the eye. But all of this trouble could have been prevented if you would have gone back, taken a close history and seen what were the drugs the patient is taking. So it's important as postgraduates, as residents, as fellows, as ophthalmologists, to be honest, that we should take into account the drugs which a patient is taking, because drug history can be extremely important in determining your diagnosis. So remember, these are some of the common drugs which are known to cause uveitis: chlorothalidone, topiramate, hydrochlorothiazide, even trimethoprim sulfamethoxazole and dimox. So if a patient present with bilateral uveitis, angle closure, peripheral choroidal detachments, keep in mind the fact that this might probably be a presentation of a drug-induced uveitis. One more case, this is a hypopyon uveitis in a patient on treatment for tuberculosis. So again, importance of drug history. When we asked the patient was taking rifabutin. And remember, our dose-dependent adverse effect of rifabutin is presence of hypopyon. So anybody taking rifabutin of more than 300 milligram can sometimes develop a hypopyon. This condition may be asymmetrical and the hypopyon may resolve just by cessation of rifabutin. So you again need to take this history if you have a patient of tuberculosis on ATT and comes back with a sudden onset of hypopyon, go back and take a history of the drugs which the patient is using. So there's a long list of drugs which are easily available in literature, but rifabutin, bisphosphonates, apart from the ones which I've already mentioned, are some of the common ones. So in a nutshell, to summarize, whenever you see patient with atypical hypopyons, things to consider are: number one, recalcitrant blood-stained hypopyons can be an indicator of blood dyscrasias. So it's important sometimes that you go ahead, get a peripheral smear done for these patients. If necessary, go ahead and take an AC tap. Bilateral hypopyons plus choroidal detachments, think of drug-induced reactions and drugs like topiramate. Hypopyons in a patient on treatment with tuberculosis, keep in mind the fact that rifabutin is known to cause a hypopyon. And hypopyons in leukemia patients, impending blast crisis, CNS spread or a relapse. And with that, I'll end my presentation. Thank you so much.
Thanks for a wonderful